Robin Williams and Harlan Ellison, Part 2.
Hey, we started last week with writer Harlan Ellison. We pick up now where we left off. I don't know, it's all so angry.
Do you believe that there are people who just come into the world cool?
Mm-hmm. Born cool.
Born cool.
The doctor smacks them and they go, take it easy. Don't cut that cord, I'm not finished. I'm just here, the lights, can you dim the light? It's getting on me.
Yeah, were you ever a dweeb?
Yeah, big time. Heavy dweeb.
Yeah, where?
Hardcore. School, especially when going to the private school, you know, this school with the blazer, the tie, the whole number.
You did that?
Oh, yeah, hardcore.
Where?
In Detroit. In a boys' school.
They have private schools in Detroit?
There's mainly Jewish, too. I went to 13 bar mitzvahs in 1 year. I got to know, I mean, I started to memorize, you know, the whole, I knew the bar mitzvah service, Brokot Hor Nanoi Eloheinu Melech Olam, and after a while they wanted to say, join, I can't, I'm sorry.
I used to love Detroit. I would go to, I had pals in Detroit, and I would just go up there, and I was involved in the most wonderful bar fight I've ever been in my life.
In Detroit.
Oh, it was, or was it Hamtramck? It was either Detroit or Hamtramck.
Well, Hamtramck is the big Polish community.
Oh, yeah, there was this, we went for barbecue. You know the House of Blue Lights?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, most people don't even know about that. There's this great jazz tune called the House of Blue Lights, and it was a barbecue joint out in the edge of town, and it was real, and you would go there and just mass the ribs, just die for the ribs, and just pig out completely. I mean, just submerge yourself in just meat on a stick, Jack. That's all it was, and it was one of them. We were there one night, and there was this horrible scream horn alto sax player, and he was up on a little platform, and he going wee wee wee, one of those awful, you know, Maynard, bad Maynard, sort of a Maynard Ferguson man K, you know, just all he knew was high notes. He would blow notes that would shatter cardboard.
Yeah, even like cats would go, oh!
And we said, God, please stop this guy. And he said, okay, we're going to take you to a cool place. So they got really cool jazz. Cool jazz. We're going to take you to cool jazz. They take you to a place called The Cave. God knows where it is now. The Cave is, you know, got to be gone. This is Fred Prophet, and it was Teddy Bear, a guy named Teddy Bear, and George Young, and all of this bunch of raffish truck drivers and pals that I knew. And they were all science fiction fans, but they all did real jobs. Like, you know, today you go to a college, and you ask people, you say, what do you do for a living? Well, I'm a computer programmer. I'm a systems analyst. Don't any of you have a fucking honest job? Is there anybody here who earns a living with their hands?
You do something with your hands.
Give me a carpenter, for God's sake, a plumber.
Do you have a skill?
Well, all of these guys had the most, you know, they were bricklayers and boilermakers, and they worked on the assembly lines, but they were all science fiction fans, and they loved to talk about it. So here I come to town, and I was just a fan, for God's sakes. So they take me into Detroit. And we go to this joint called The Cave. We go downstairs, down. And it was down below everything, the pipes and the ceiling. Look like those weird scenes in Funny Face, you know. And goddamn if it wasn't the same sax player.
The same guy
blowing the same shit jazz. It was awful.
I gotta have two gigs, baby. Well,
and I don't drink, so I'm drinking lemonade or Coke, you know, whatever the hell it is. But we're sitting there listening to the music, and all of a sudden, at the bar, there were two Canadian soldiers who were wearing kilts. And it was a bar filled with, you know, horny-handed sons of Doyle, you know, guys with muscles and between their ears, and these were people who for whom the idea of a thought was like a breeze blowing across a long arid pampas, and they started ragging on these two guys, and they were just sitting there minding their own business, and the one guy said to him something like, you know, leave us alone, stop bothering us, we're not bothering you, just leave us alone. Oh, you don't want to be bothered. Oh, the lady don't want to be bothered. And he either swatted him across the back of the head or something. And these two guys stood up, and they were the equivalent of Rangers. They were British commando type kind of guys, and they were big, and they were well turned out. And they grabbed one guy grabbed him by the neck, and the other guy grabbed him by the ankles, and they bent him like a croquet wicket. Over a bar stool, just like that. The next thing I knew, the joint was a John Wayne bar fight, and people are punching each other and throwing things. And I ducked for cover under the. They had one of those skee ball the things, you know, with the big puck. The big puck. I went underneath that boy. I got out of the way because I was a little fella and I didn't want to get hurt. And people are punching each other, throwing chairs through the back bar mirror. It was exactly like some crazed a John Ford movie. It was really insane. And I thought, well, what the hell? Why don't I get into this, too? So I grabbed the puck from up above.
And fling it?
I flang it. I hit some guy in the side of the head, knocked him slant over backwards. It hit the mirror, knocked 13 bottles off. It was amazing. We all ran for cover. The cops came. They dragged everybody in. We got out through the kitchen. It was a wonderful evening.
This is the life I never knew about you.
Oh, I wasn't even in college yet.
Serious?
No, I wasn't even in college. I think I was still in high school. And I was a science fiction fan from about 1950.
Who was your favorite writer when you were reading then, when you started off reading science fiction?
My favorite writer? Well, you're going to think this is insane.
No. Me? No.
Well, most of the ones who are my favorites, it's been a long time since they've written. Wallace West was one of my favorites. Wallace West wrote The Bird of Time. It was a wonderful story. But among my favorites was L. Ron Hubbard.
Serious?
This is long before he started doing Dianetics. L. Ron Hubbard was one of the best pulp writers in the country.
Serious?
I'm telling you, kid, you want to read a great book? Read Slaves of Sleep. Read Slan. Slan is the best novel about mutants ever written in the field.
Slan.
Slan. S-L-A-N. It's about a kid named Johnny Cross, who is a mutant, and they chase him. He did a book called Final Blackout. The first edition of it is worth a fortune. Final Blackout is a small, thin book that was published in installments in Astounding Science Fiction, and it's after a nameless war. I mean, it's obviously a paradigm for World War I, mm-hmm. but it's about the lieutenant, and he wanders through this war-blasted landscape trying to find civilization. It's brilliant. Hubbard was one of the most adept storytellers there ever was. I tell the story, but there are a dozen other science fiction writers who could tell the same story of different nights, because it happened a lot of times. It happened on a night, I was still in high school, and I had come to New York, and I was hanging out with Lester Del Rey and Algis Budrys and Harry Harrison and all these people who belonged to the Hydra Club. The Hydra Club was a writers drinking and schmoozing society. They would get together once a week or once every 2 weeks in Jay Stanton's apartment, and which is down on First Avenue. And they would stand around and they would just talk, and there would be L. Sprague DeCamp. There's a great story told about L. Sprague DeCamp. L. Sprague DeCamp is supposed to be this great writer of funny stories. He's one of the great. Everybody says, "Oh, he writes very funny stories," and he does. And they told me that one night they noticed Sprague, who's a tall, slim, very ascetic gentleman with a mustache. I mean, he looks like something out of a Louis Auchincloss novel, you know, or the late George Apley. I mean, he really looks. He's an elegant, well turned out man who speaks very precisely, very academically. And he had a pad and pencil, and he would stand behind a group of people who were talking, and he would be writing things down. So finally, after about 3 hours, people jumped him. They said, "Come on, Sprague, what the hell are you writing?" And they looked. And he had been writing down all of the funny things that people said because he wanted to figure out how humor worked. He didn't understand.
He was trying to analyze.
He was trying to analyze. He was trying to dissect it and put it. I mean, that's the kind of even. Anyhow, so Hubbard was there. Now Hubbard was legendary among the pulp writers. He'd been writing pulp stories for years. Most of his biography was made up. It was, you know, he created his own mythology about himself. But one of the things that was true about him was that he was one of the very first writers ever to have an electric typewriter. And he had one of those huge, original...
IBM Selectric? I think it was
even before an IBM Selectric. It was something like a big L.C. Smith. I mean, it was just gigantic. It was, you know, if you tied it around someone's feet, you could put them in a bay and no one would ever find them. Forget about it. So, he tried to figure out a way to write faster because you're only being paid a penny a word, 2 cents a word, 3 cents a word. That was the max. That's all you got. The best markets paid 3 cents a word when you caught them. Didn't you know that?
No. Yeah, they pay by the word.
They pay by the word. Of course. That's the way I wrote. When I started writing in 1955, 56, I got paid a penny a word. I would sit up all night. I'd write a 3,000-word short story. I'd take it in the next day to Ziff Davis Publishing at 1 Park Avenue, and they would read it right on the spot, and Paul Fremont would say, "Okay, I'll buy it, and give me a voucher for $30. And I would take it down. I'd go and pay my rent. I was living in a $10-a-week room. So $30 was three
Boom.
Weeks. Yeah. In those days, you could get a spaghetti dinner at Ronzoni's on Times Square. I was working in Times Square. I was working at the Broadway Bookshop between the Victoria and Astor Theaters. God. It was wonderful. That's when I got to see Gwen Verdon naked. Anyway,
This alone is worth the price
of
admission.
No.
Woo!
Trust me, you don't want to go there.
Okay.
So I worked the shift. It was Broadway in those days was great because I worked the 6 o'clock in the evening shift till 3 in the morning. And after midnight was when all the interracial couples came out, was when all the real kookaboos and cadotes came out. It was a great time.
Oh, man, that must have been wonderful.
It was a wonderful time. And right across the street was the Ronzoni Spaghetti House. And you could get a spaghetti dinner with 2 meatballs and bread and coffee or iced tea for a buck. And it was, and I would eat there every night, and down the street was pizza was 15 cents a slice.
Wow.
And I would go over to the flea circus and listen to Tiny Tim play his mandolin. Except he wasn't called Tiny Tim then; he had another name.
He was just starting.
It was great times. Oh, I was telling you about Hubbard with the typewriter.
Right.
To become faster, because he was only being paid a penny a word, 2 cents a word, 3 cents a word, he had attached to the wall, he worked against a wall, had a little table set against the wall. On the wall behind the table where the typewriter sat, he had installed one of those spindles that butchers have the brown paper on, a roll of brown paper.
Oh, yeah.
And he would roll the brown paper, the butcher's paper, into the typewriter and start typing. And when it got too much, he would rip it off with a T-square. He would rip it off and throw it behind him and keep typing. And that's how he would take the manuscript in. And that way he didn't have to stop to put paper in the typewriter.
So he's cranking at that point.
He was really cranking it, but he wrote a lot. He wrote not just science fiction, but he wrote westerns, he wrote mysteries, he wrote all kinds of stuff. But the novels, the fantasy novels, The Slaves of Sleep, The Triton that he did were wonderful, wonderful stuff. And Slan is Van Vogt. I'm sorry, Slan is Van Vogt. Slan is not Hubbard. Hubbard did A Final Blackout, Slaves of Sleep, The Triton, and about 2 dozen others, but they're really well worth reading. Fear. He did a book called Fear.
What's that about?
Fear is the first psychological horror novel. It's all, literally about fear. He did one called Death's Deputy. He read somewhere that insurance adjusters had a table where they had lists of people to whom accidents don't happen, but everybody around them have accidents, and he called the guy a death's deputy, and he tells this, it's a wonderful story about this guy who wanders through life, and all around him people are dying and falling off buildings, all this shit. Beautiful book. He also did one called Typewriter in the Sky, where this guy realizes that his life is being written by God in a dirty bathrobe, sitting on the edge of a bed with a typewriter. So, well, I got a mind full of this crap.
It's incredible to hear all these connections. I don't think people know.
He must have had a dozen pseudonyms, and the ones of the Kilkenny Cats were written on the name Kurt von Rachen. So I met this evening. And I'm just a high school kid, and I've come in from Cleveland, Ohio, for Christ's sake, and I'm in among the giants, for God's sakes, and I'm just sort of sitting there quietly. And Lester Del Rey, who was a very well known writer, and subsequently became Del Rey Books, and blah 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 blah. Lester, in his childhood, had been a stump minister like Marjo Gortner. He had been a revivalist. He was a child evangelist. And so Ron was complaining that he was breaking his ass writing, and he was never going to get, you know, they would find him slumped over the typewriter one day. This is how, because there was no annuity, there's no insurance, there's no nothing, and you can't keep it up forever. I mean, I've been at it for 50 years, for God's sakes. I'm lucky still to be able to write. And these guys were sort of in sight of that, and they knew that they had to do something, and Ron said there's got to be a better way to make money. So Lester says, start a religion. That's the way to do it. Start a religion. And he said, and Ron said, yeah, not a bad, now what kind of a religion? Well, one guy contributed Reich's Organ Box. Another one came up with engrams, which were, you know, forgotten lost memory or whatever it was. And sure enough, Ron went ahead and he cobbled up Dianetics, and he wrote this book.
Because it has a little bit of all of that.
All of that stuff in it, and it took off, and he became very, very famous. And now, of course, he's a god, and you dare not say anything again, you know, that this happened this way. But now other people have told me that they were at similar evenings where the same kind of thing happened. So I don't know whether my evening was the one, or one of the ones, or whether it was the seed had already been planted. But when I told this story at Roddy McDowell's dinner, suddenly next to me, Julia McGinnis Johnson, this opera singer, went out of her Mesopotamian mind. So Roddy comes out. Roddy, I was terribly shaken, because I didn't want to be disrespectful to Roddy. I liked him a lot, and here I had ruined his goddamn dinner. So I'm sitting out on the veranda and just kind of shaking, and Roddy comes out and he sits down and he goes, "Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God." I said, "You might have told me that she was a Scientologist, you jerk." And he says, "I forgot."
That ended the party.
Oh yeah, yeah,
in a big way.
Yeah. Roddy called for days there after saying, it wasn't your fault, but we were never invited back, and then he died.
Oh God, man, that's like the last party.
These things happen to me constantly. Oh. No matter where I go, some shit happens. I don't know what it is.
And then why did you get kicked out of college? What did you do?
Okay, so here's what happened. My dad died in 49. We were living in Painesville, Ohio, a little town about 30 miles northeast of Cleveland. My dad dropped dead on a Sunday morning right in front of me. And it busted me up bad, but I didn't know it. I didn't realize it. I'd been a straight-A student up till that point. Well, suddenly I started just... I couldn't get grades or anything. We moved to Cleveland, my mother and I, and she was working in the B'nai B'rith thrift shop. We had no money. I mean, we were pretty broke, because my dad had died broke. He was a good guy, but never earned a lot of money. And he was a jeweler and a dentist. And anyhow, so the only school I could go to was a state school, which is Ohio State. So I go to Ohio State. And I was and they paid for my tuition, but to pay for my room and my books and things like that, I was working at different jobs. I was a short order cook. I worked as a waiter in fraternity houses until I dumped a 20-gallon can of milk over one of the actives, and I didn't know quite what I wanted to do, because I had been a singer, I had sung for a living, and I'd been an actor, and I'd been writing and doing all these things, but I wanted to write basically, and there was this writing class that I was in. Now Ohio State has a popular, even at that time, which was 1953, had a population of 256 billion people. The writing class had six people in it. Six people. And it was run by a Dr. Shedd.
Dr. Shedd?
Dr. Shedd. S-H-E-D-D. And Shedd. And in this class was one guy who was a Cro-Magnoid type, you know, the sort of fellow whose knuckles scraped the ground as he walked.
Good.
And
good.
So he was taking it just for credit. There was a young woman who, to my certain knowledge, never said a word, and you could pass your hand in front of her eyes, and all that would happen was be you see the Doppler effect of your hand going past her head. And there was an old woman who wrote this astrological poetry, and here was me writing stories like a mad thing. I mean, I was doing a story a day, just sending them in, you know, and they were all, of course, they were fantasy and science fiction and weird stuff and Lovecraftian stuff, because that's what I was interested in, and writing all of this stuff. And Shedd would... He would hand back the manuscripts with a C on it or a D on it or you know a nice paper or you know that kind of thing, and finally one time, this was the first of the four things that got me kicked out. All four of these things I'll tell you about happened all at the same time. Well, wait, should I tell you about the fraternity first? Yeah, my mother. Let me back up once. You remember Brother Theodore?
Oh, Brother Theodore, the greatest stage performer.
The greatest
stage. He's the one that said, "I may look like shit to you, that's because stage lighting is in its infancy."
I'll give you, you want to hear my invitation of theater? Oh, I love Teddy. Teddy and I met. He was one of the few people I ever wanted to meet. I mean, we're talking here a man in his 90s who was a brilliant monologist. He wasn't a comedian. He wasn't stand-up.
No, he just tell stories.
He would just tell stories. But he said, once, and this is my invitation, and now you tell me if this is a good invitation of Brother Theodore. "You know, David, I have been working on training rats. You know, yes, you can train a rat. Yes, if you take a rat and you work for days and months and years, you can train a rat. Of course, when you finish, all you have is a trained rat." I loved Teddy. And when we met, when we finally met, we hit it off instantly. I thought I was going to take him to dinner and we would chat for a while. We sat for 6.5 hours in Otto Penzler's drawing room, that great Sherlock Holmes drawing room in the Mysterious Bookshop in New York.
Yeah.
And we just couldn't stop talking. And his life was astonishing. Mm-hmm. Astonishing. He escaped from Nazi Germany. His wife, who was this gorgeous movie actress, fell in love with this syphilitic German director in Hollywood and left him. Oh, it was an amazing story. And we sat and we told each other's life stories to each other. And at one point, Teddy says to me, he says, "You know, Harlan, we are very much alike in one respect." And I said, what's that, Teddy? He said, "Well,
Women find us fascinating. When they meet us, they say, ah, there is life here. There is vibrance. There is verve, zeal. I wish to know it. I wish to be with it. I wish to cleave to it. And it's good. And it's good for a month and 2 months and three. And then when will he shut up? Will be there no end? Will he stop talking? And then they run shrieking from us into the street. And I fell apart.
Oh, man.
And my wife, truly, my wife is the only person in my entire life, including my mother and father, who could bear to be in my company more than 2 hours without running screaming.
Just shying from the room.
Absolutely. So my mother, my poor dear mother, she was the sweetest woman in the world, and I adored her, but she didn't have a clue. It was as if these two pandas had given birth to a wolverine. They had no idea. I was in trouble from the day I was born. There was not a day of my life when I was not in some kind of hot water. I mean, just one thing after another. And my poor mother, she says to me when I go to college, she says, join a fraternity. Be with your own kind.
Your own kind?
Well, Jews.
Jews. A Jewish fraternity.
Right.
I'm looking for the one Jewish fraternity.
So when I got to Ohio State, I applied to work on the Ohio State Sundial, which was the humor magazine. And in the heyday of great college humor magazines, the Harvard Lampoon and the Dartmouth magazine, outstanding among them was the Ohio State Sundial, for which James Thurber had worked, Ruth McKinney had worked, Milton Caniff had worked, Gardner Ray, the great New Yorker cartoonist,
right.
All of those people had worked for. And I was the first freshman ever to work on the Sundial. So when I went around and they were pledging for the fraternities, they had all of these slope-browed, prognathous-jawed imbeciles who were football players or whose father owned a Westinghouse dealership in Toledo, Ohio, and they drove around in a red Cadillac convertible, and they had all these guys. So they needed some guy like me that they thought would raise the the point level, in the little did they know that I was going to bomb out completely. So I got pledged to ZBT, Zeta Beta Tomato, the baby powder fraternity. And I was in it for one semester, and they hated me. Now, you got to understand something. I've been on the road since I was 13. So now I'm 18, 19, whatever the hell it is when you're in college. And these pissants, these little pussy willows, are saying to me, hey, you, shine my shoes. I said, hey, fuck you. Go shine your own shoes. What, you got a broken arm? So I was not terribly fraternal. So
this was not playing the game.
So they harassed me, it was constant hell week for me all the time, and I didn't take any shit from anybody. And during midterms, I remember I was trying to study, and I finally got to sleep at about 2 in the morning, and they came in, they dragged me out of bed, and they made me go downstairs and clean out the garbage shed. And I flunked my test the next day. So the next night, same thing happened. I studied as long as I could, and I finally fell asleep over my desk. And here they came, these actives, all of them wearing ties and jackets, you know. And they dragged me out onto the dorm rooms were on the third floor of this fraternity house, which was up on a hill in Columbus, Ohio. And they took me out on the fire escape. And they were going to take me down to the garbage shed to, you know, clean out the garbage shed again. And one of these guys made the mistake of shoving me. And I grabbed him by the tie, and I threw him over the railing. I just yanked the tie, and he went right over the railing. He went right through the roof of the garbage shed. And the next day, they suggested that I leave the fraternity house because I wasn't a terribly fraternal fellow. Yeah. So I went So I went to live in this rooming house. And it was tough times for me. I didn't like college. I didn't like it at all. So now I'm handing in these stories, and the professor Shedd he obviously has nothing but disdain for me. He doesn't know what the hell I'm doing. He doesn't like the stories. They're obviously trash and garbage, and, you know, I'm nothing. And finally, I confronted him, because that's the kind of hairpin I am. I confronted this guy, and I said, look, Dr. Shedd, I need you to give me an honest analysis of my work. I mean, you know, do I have any talent, for God's sakes? Now, you got to understand something. I had been publishing my own magazine at this point, my own fanzine. I'd been publishing it for 5 years, Dimensions. I had a subscribership of over 1,000 people, and everybody was writing me, Asimov and Heinlein, and all these people were writing for my magazine. And I was writing stories, and I was being mentored by Algis Budrys and Lester Del Rey and people like that. And I was not great, but I had some ability, for God's sakes. And he said to me, and this is not verbatim, but it was very much like this. He said, you have no talent. You have no talent. You will never have any talent. He said, you cannot write. He said, if you persist in batting your wings against the window like a moth, you will only come to no good. He said, if anybody should ever read anything you write, they would never buy it. If a miracle should be passed and they buy it, it would not stand the test of time. You are no good. You have no talent. And he said, I understand you're minoring in geology. You probably have rocks in your head. Why don't you go ahead and do that? And I hit him. I hit him as hard as I could possibly hit him. Now, I'd been on the road for a lot of years, and I may not have been terribly muscular. That didn't come till the Army. But I knew that when you hit somebody, you don't hit to them, you hit beyond them. And I hit right to the back of his head, and I got to his jaw doing about 180 miles an hour and knocked him right on his ass. That was the first thing.
That'll work.
The second thing is I got arrested for shoplifting.
What were you stealing?
I was stealing records, and they caught me, and they threw me in the slam in Columbus, Ohio, and that was the second thing. The third thing was, because I'd been on the road since I was young, I knew nothing about girls. I never kissed a girl till I was 19. I never got laid till I was 20, and I got married at 21. So here I am in college, and I somehow or other got this date for there were three big dances. There was the homecoming dance, the something or other dance, and the military ball, which was put on by the ROTC people. And I somehow managed to get this date with Mona Green. I mean, just, oh.
The goddess.
Oh, Mona Green to die. And what she was doing with an asshole like me, I have no idea. But I called my mother and I begged her, Mama, please let me take the bus to Cleveland. Let me get the car. Let me have the car for the weekend. And she said, okay. I took the Greyhound to Cleveland from Columbus. I got the car. I drove it back. I figured if I got a car, maybe I'll get lucky. Who the hell knows? So for some reason that I cannot parse, I drove my car, my mother's car, up the long walk at Ohio State University and onto the statue of William Oxley Thompson. Why I did that, and who the hell William Oxley Thompson was, I'll never be able to tell you. And the guard, there was a campus cop who came after me, old guy, very, very fat, and he chased me, and he had a heart attack, and he fell down. He didn't die, but oh yeah, the poor man, he fell down.
At this point now, you've decked the professor?
That's the three. Yeah, now, the fourth one was, I had the lowest, probably to this day.
The lowest grade point average?
Lowest grade point average in the history of Ohio State University.
Negative?
4 point, well, damn close. 4 point is straight A's.
Right.
I had .084, which is three X's, two F's, and a question mark. I don't know.
How do you get it .084? What I want to know is how did you get .084? So what was the .084? What did you do that good? I mean, what was the 8.084 for?
I attended.
I showed up. That's the credit for your body.
I showed up.
That's essentially for your fluids.
Well, they booted me out. They booted me out. And I stood there. It was in February. And I stood there in the snow on High Street looking at the university, and I had with me the little cardboard box that I sent my dirty laundry home.
Yeah.
And I stood there and I shook my fist at them and I said, I'll be back. I'll be back, motherfuckers. I'll be back. And you'll see. Well, years later, when I was on a lecture tour of Ohio, I'm in the middle of the week and I get a call from the agent. And he says, Ohio State would like you. Can you work them in? I said, sure. They paid double. And I was making some ridiculous figure, like $3,000 or $4,000. Now I get $6,000, $8,000, $10,000 a night. But then I was making maybe $3,000. They paid $6,000. And when I got up to do my evening, the joint was jammed. It was the hall was filled and the balcony was filled. And I started out by saying, you know, I used to go to school here, folks. Now, I suppose I could tell you about the train that the fraternity boys at ZBT used to pull on the poor half-witted girl who came in from town, and 16 or 20 of them would use her up and then give her a dollar and a half and send her home on the bus. I said, or I could tell you about the Jewish quota in the medical school so that my friend Don Epstein, who had 4 point, couldn't get in, and he went to dental school and couldn't get in that quota either. So then he went to the taxidermist school and finally wound up in vet school and changed his name to Don Forrester and married a Shiksa. I could tell you about that. And I went on, man, in this vein for about 2 hours without drawing a breath, talking about Ohio State and about this joint is so goddamn stupid. The only reason you can get thrown out of this place is if you miss a forward pass. And I went on at great, great, great length. And then suddenly at some point or other, it was as if I opened my mouth and the dove of peace flew out. It was an epiphany. I said, free at last? Free at last? Thank God Almighty, I am free at last. And I went ahead and I did 2 hours of a regular lecture.
So you spoke for 4 hours?
4 hours. And when I got done, they wouldn't pay me. We didn't bring you in here to disrespect our university. We're not going to pay you. I said, oh, that's fine. And I said, don't pay me. I said, I'm sure that Cynthia Robbins, who's standing right here of the Columbus Dispatch, and you notice she has her pad out. She's going to love to run the headline, you know, OSU refuses to pay poor little Kike.
I've never seen that headline. No. Kike dissed by you.
They paid me very, very quickly. In fact, I wouldn't leave the auditorium until they went and got a check. And to this day, I will not give a lecture unless I have the check in my hand before I speak.
You have no choice.
If you have the mind,
yes,
it
works for you. We just what is your favorite story that you've written? The one that you is you know the. It's like asking someone pick your favorite child, but it's like
yeah.
But
well,
what is
I've
the
got
one...
1,700 stories. I got 74 books. So when people ask me that, I usually say it's the story I'm writing now, which is called Incognita Inc., as in Terra Incognita.
Right.
And the concept is this. If you look at the movie King Kong,
right,
they got this map of Skull Island that was found with a Lithuanian seaman who was found in a bark floating out in the middle of the Sargasso Sea, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or the map to Atlantis, or Arne Saknussemm has a map to the center of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Who makes these fucking maps? Who's the cartographer who makes these maps?
Wait, there's like there is a place where they've...
Well, this is the story about this little map shop in Old Town in Chicago with this little guy, this Dickensian shop, where the guy does the... And it's the day when the corporation that bought the shop comes to fire him, because now they've got
GPS locators.
GPS locators. They don't need him anymore. And it's the guy who comes to tell him that he has to be, they're going to give him a nice severance package because he's been working there for 400 years. And they're going to give him a nice little severance package, but I'm sorry, we don't need you anymore. And he's come to fire him. The guy who's letting him go, it turns out, is a guy that he had been at this shop 30 years before when he was a little boy. He had won a bronze medal in a kite flying contest. It was the only thing he'd ever won, and he had lost the bronze medal, and he went to this map shop, and the map shop said, we have maps to anywhere, and he said, can you give me a map to my heart's desire, which is my little bronze medal? And the old man gave him the map, and he found his bronze medal, and now he's been picked by this company to fire this guy, and he's really upset about it, and he lets him go, and it's being told by this guy, it's being narrated by this guy, and he says, I my heart was breaking, and I knew I was quitting the company, I would never, you know, fuck them, I would never do their dirty work for them again, and he said, and I watched the old man, he had a carpet bag, and he walked out in the street, and he started to turn to the left to walk, and a woman stopped him and said, excuse me, can you tell me where the supermarket is? And he says, yes, you go... Wait a minute, I'll draw you a map.
Oh, that works.
Is that great?
That's really lovely.
I love that. It's so...
That's
people say, where do you get your ideas? I always say Schenectady. They say, what? I say, yeah, there's this idea service.
Yeah, you knock on the door then.
Send them $25 a week. They send me a fresh 6-pack of ideas every week without a fail. And there's always some schmuck after the lecture comes up and says, can I have the address of that idea service? You get an idea, and the idea comes like with you, with a shtick you're going to do.
Yeah,
you say, what a funny idea. Who makes the maps? Where do these forgotten maps come from suddenly for Atlantis and Mu and Eden and Utopia and all these things? And then you say, okay, but that's just an idea. That's not a story. That's not a story. The story is, who makes the maps? What's his life like? What's going to happen to him? Why are you telling his story? And a short story is always that pivot moment. It is that burning moment in which you see everything that went before and everything that will follow thereafter. And it's that linchpin moment. And to tie that up, you have to have the point. And the point, of course, is what makes it a story. And for months and months and months, maybe years, I guess years, the idea sat there and I couldn't do anything with it. And I knew exactly what I wanted to write. I knew what the guy looked like. I could see him in my head, this Dickensian little shop with him sitting on a stool. And
like those ones in England with the globe.
Yeah, absolutely. Drawing his little maps and but I couldn't figure out an ending. Also, I couldn't figure out viewpoint. And then one morning I was taking a shower. I get great ideas in the shower. That's where I get ablution. For some reason, I run scenarios. I do all the parts myself. It's like you.
Yeah.
In the different voices, and I'm talking, and I do the whole scenario. And I suddenly got the... I said, oh, that's what it is. It doesn't have to be, yes, and he was carried off in a blaze of light to him.
No.
Here, let me draw you a map.
That's a...
Bam! And it just killed me.
It's just like, bing!
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the simplest stuff. Like the simplest and the most powerful. This is a good thing.
You know, we don't get to sit and talk like this anymore.
That's why I love doing it. That's why today's been good.
Yes.
God willing.
Ugh. Okay.
Oh, boss.
Well, now, listen, it was wonderful seeing you, Rob. You come on back now sometime soon.
I'm going to take some toasters. Give Harlan a gift here. We got every goddamn story ever made.
I'd like the mangle. My mother had a mangle. It was in the front yard for a long time.
It's a sweet thing. Take some gifts, and we're done right now. We did our time. It's time to also say to everybody, you know what we're doing.
Oh, God, we did it, Ike.